Thank you. Let us pray. Gracious God, we come to you today. We ask that your Holy Spirit be a part of this service. We have lit these candles here today to designate this time as special in our lives, in our days. We're saying that we are putting everything aside that we have brought in or what we may be worrying about later on and focusing in on what that Holy Spirit is going to offer us today through fellowship, through music, through the reading of Scripture, and through a message. Allow that Holy Spirit to guide us, to uplift us, to fortify us as we go today, giving us what we need so that we can walk a little bit more perfectly in the footsteps of Christ here and now at this place and at this time. God, we ask that this Holy Spirit extend beyond the walls of this church to all of those who are watching remotely. We are separated physically, but we are united as a church with that Holy Spirit. God, we also ask that Holy Spirit extend to all of those who may have heard our bell ring this morning. Allow the prevenient grace of God to be working in their lives and in their place to bring them closer to a relationship with a community of faith, whether it is here or elsewhere, so that they too can know the joy and the love of your gospel through Jesus Christ. And we do this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our announcements for today, the CUOC food collection for July is cereal and pasta salad. United Women of Faith, third quarter, which is July through September. They're going to be donating to the Living Room in Greensboro. It's a store for foster parents. The church logo, we are taking submissions for new logo for Old Union. They need to get to Jeffrey by paper, or if you want to email them. He just needs them so they can be scanned in the computer for the presentation at the next church meeting. He would like those today so that they could be ready for the meeting next week. Regularly scheduled church council meeting is going to be next Sunday, immediately following Sunday school closing. High Point Rockers baseball game is Sunday, July 23rd at 4:05 p.m., if you're going, go ahead and be at the church here at 3 p.m. Youth ministry, no meeting in July. Next meeting is going to be August 27th. End of summer party is going to be August 19th, 4 p.m., 7 p.m. All the information there to go ahead and share with your family, friends, and neighbors about that. And then the United Women, the UWF fall event is going to be Saturday, November the 11th at 10 a.m., a lot of fun last year with the vendors and all that went along with that. So share with that with those who may have a craft or would like to get a space there and get that information out. Any other announcements? The reading of our psalm this morning. Thank you.
The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love.
The Lord is good to all. And his compassion is over all he has made.
All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your faithful shall bless you.
They shall speak the glory of your kingdom and tell your power.
To make known to all people your mighty deeds and the glorious splendor of your kingdom.
Your kingdom is everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. The Lord is faithful in all his words and gracious in all his deeds.
The Lord upholds all who are falling and raises up all who are bowed down.
Amen. It's time to take a moment to center ourselves. If you like to sing in the choir, please make your way forward.
Something new inside me. pizza, you smoothie, me ice cold pizza, cafe ole, latte da. You do the Zumba, but I do not. Give me like half a marathon. I'll give you the gospel of St. John. Hits me like a wake up.
Serious.
Center page 284. 284.
I don't know which one is 284.
It's so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon him.
Thank you.
Join with me as we recite the Apostles' Creed, and as we do, allow these words to guide our footsteps as we practice following Jesus each and every day and each and every moment. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he descended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From this he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. Good morning. How you guys doing? Let me see all your fingers. Got to make sure that they're all there after the 4th of July. Good. All right. I see that. That's nice. So we need to find out if there's any birthdays that we need to celebrate this week. Any that we need to know about? Yeah. Okay. All right. Oh, okay. Good, good, good. Any others? All right. Well, let's go ahead and sing. Ready?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
All right. Any anniversaries to celebrate? No July weddings. Okay. All right. Well, let's go ahead. Today, we're going to be talking about something that I think that you might have experienced. How many of you have sets of rules that you follow either at home or at school or at the sports field? We're getting there. We're getting there. All right, so we all have rules that we have, right? Now, my next question is, do we always follow those rules, colon? That's right. But you know the rules are there, right? And you know that you should probably follow them, but sometimes it's hard for us, and we just do what we want to do sometimes, right? Yeah, so that's what we are talking about today, as the Apostle Paul is telling us that, you know what, God created us in incredible ways and knit us together in our mother's womb before we were even born. But we have something in our lives that we struggle with, that he struggled with, and we have to figure out how to deal with it. And that is to do the right thing most of the time and all of the time. Even though we might not want to, we have to figure out how to do that. And he is struggling with that, which means that we are struggling with that too. And he gave us one clear answer of how we are to go ahead and get through those times. When we're struggling, we know we have a rule and we know we're supposed to follow it, but we want to do something else. He says his go-to, his rescue in this is who? Jesus, that's right. We look to Jesus for help and to rescue us in those times when we are struggling with what to do and how to do something. So when you are ever in a situation where you know that the rules are there and you may think you may not want to follow them, I want you to think about what Jesus would do in that moment. Would Jesus follow those rules? And what would Jesus think of you if you continue to go ahead and not do what those rules are? Because most rules are there for our protection, to keep us safe, and to keep other people safe, right? Most of them, yeah. Well, He's talking about Scripture, and Scripture is our kind of sets of guidelines to keep us safe and to give us a better and safe life. So we can always look to that too. So just think about that the next time you are in that place of wanting to break one of those rules, okay? Let's see some prayer fingers. Ready, set, pray. Gracious God, we come to you today, and we're grateful for children in church and the parents and guardians that brought them. We just want you to watch over them, guide them as they go about their day, and give us the ability to see the kingdom of God through them. It is through their eyes that we are able to see a little bit truer aspects of our reality that we have kind of looked past. So we do this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, here you go. One for you, one for you, one for you. Thank you. You're welcome. As we go into a time of praises and prayers, we have those on our prayer list that we are lifting up. Are there any others that we need to lift up specifically at this time? Oh, okay. Yes. Ah. Yes.
Keep it Gary Cavanaugh's family.
Any others? Okay. Well, let us go to God in prayer this morning. Gracious God, we come to you today and we lift up all of these requests. We know that you are present and active in all these situations. Give those who are deep in these situations the eyes and ears to hear and see your presence in this place and time. Just give them what they need in order to get through this moment, through this time, or this situation. Just be with them. Provide them peace and calm, joy, whatever they may need at this time and place. God, we lift up all of those that are away from their families this morning for whatever reason, whether they're serving this country here in the United States or around the world, or if they are responding to a disaster, providing water or shelter or food. Just be with all of those who are away from their comfort zones and their homes and their spaces of worship. Just be with them as they travel, as well as all of those who are still traveling from the holiday weekend. Just be with them as they make their way home with peace and joy in their hearts, hoping that they have been restored and rejuvenated during their time of vacation. God, we lift up all of those who are suffering this morning, whether it is looking at the destruction of their church or their home or their business, for whatever reason, figuring out what they're going to do next, just be with them and guide them and let them know that your presence is there and that you are able to help them during this time. God, we lift up all of those who are taking care of those people that can't care for themselves. We often overlook the caretakers, and they themselves need our prayers and our support and our love as they go about what they have been called and what God has put on their hearts to do today for a loved one or a friend or even a stranger. be with them and guide them and uplift them, letting them know that they are taking care of the least of these, and therefore they are taking care of you. God, we are continually in prayer for all of those who are in war zones around the world, conflict zones around the world, wherever it may be. Just be with them, provide them safety and comfort as they are surviving these situations, and be with those who are making decisions in all of these places and situations. Guide them to hopefully to a peaceful and quick end to these conflicts. God, we lift up all of these. We also lift up all of those that we don't, all those prayer requests that we don't feel comfortable voicing right now, those that were hanging on deep inside of us, or those that you who are watching remotely may have. This is your opportunity to lift those up to God so that God can be working in those places and in those situations. And we do this with the prayer that you taught your disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, and deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our reading today is from the book of Romans, chapter 7, verses 15 through 25. Hear these words. I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good, but in fact, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is, in my flesh. I can will what is right, but I cannot do it. For I do not do the good that I want, but the evil I do not want is what I do. Now, if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. So I find it to be a law that when I want to do what is good, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my innermost self, but I see in my members another law at war with the law of my mind, making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord, so that with my mind I am a slave to the law of God, but with my flesh I am a slave to the law of sin. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
In my Ranger years, I can kind of reflect on the number of contacts that I had with people, the number of law enforcement contacts specifically, hundreds of them, thousands of them on a regular basis, and very rarely did we come in contact with somebody that said, yep, I did it, that was me, that was all me, I admit it. It was more like, most of the time was like, what have I done? Or I can't believe this. And even those who are not involved or people that knew those people that were involved, they would say things like, this is not like him or her. I don't know who they are, and I don't recognize them at this moment. And we even see this if we watch those police shows or even the news about the horrific events violence that we see in our society, where parents or loved ones or friends are like, he was a nice guy. I didn't know who he was. You know, I could never imagine him doing this. And I think if we are honest with ourselves, and remember we are in church this morning, we can all kind of reflect on those moments where we are doing something that we know is not right, but we do it anyway, and we're kind of going, what am I doing? Why am I here? And that is the struggle that we see Paul with today in verse 15. He's basically saying, I don't understand my actions. And if you break those words down in the root language, he's basically saying, look, I know what I'm supposed to do, but I'm not doing it. And I just can't wrap my head around why this is. And Paul is tapping into one of the greatest human dilemmas that we face. Why do I do the thing that I hate? And why is that? And what drives us to that point? And we have to look at what Paul is saying here. Now, this is those moments where we have agency in this situation. There are times when people do things based upon addiction, where they're so far gone into that addiction, into that substance, that they're no longer acting of themselves. It is the substance that is driving that person, and they are not there. Or there are issues with mental health issues where that person does not have the capacity to respond to a certain situation or be responsible for their actions. This is not what Paul is talking about. Paul is talking about where we have agency in these moments, where we know what's going on, but yet we still are going down that path. We are still going down that way of doing things that we know we shouldn't be doing. And this is a clear ending for us as we talk about what it means to practice following Jesus, because this is where that rubber meets the road. Are we going to act this way or are we going to act that way? And it's this balance between, like we talked about last week, our faith and the authority that we live under, the church and the state, remembering that our founders basically said that we need a wall between the garden of the church and the wilderness of the world, but there is that tension that is there. And here we have, Paul has brought that tension down to a personal level, down to ourselves and each and every one of us as he reflects upon that spiritual life of the body and of the flesh and of the world and of who we are in Christ. And this is one of those big motifs or themes in Paul's literature. You see it all over the place. He's always dealing with this duality of the body of the earth and the mind and the spirit of God and what we're supposed to be doing and how we're supposed to be behaving as followers of Christ. What that looks like in this situation and in Christian tradition throughout history is this idea of the true self versus the false self, and how that plays into how we live our lives. And all throughout history, theologians and those who reflect upon this have talked about what this the division between true and false self is. Richard Rohr, in a book called Falling Forward, very transformative book of faith, he said, I believe that God gives us our soul, our deepest identity, our true self, our unique blueprint at our own immaculate conception. Our unique little bit of heaven is installed by the manufacturer, God, within the product, us, or humanity. At the beginning, we are given a span of years to discover it, to choose it, and to live our own destiny to the fullest. He says that the Zen masters would call this, we need to discover the face that we had before we were born. Using a lot of quotes today, just because it is, there are those that have said this much clearer than I could ever. Thomas Merton, Christian mystic, basically says, our false selves are the identities that we cultivate in order to function in society with pride and self-possession. Our real selves are a deep religious mystery known entirely only to God. The world cultivates the false self, ignores the real one, and therein lies the great irony of human existence. The more that we make of ourselves, the less we actually exist. Two sides of us in the world and how we live. Now, most of us spend most of our lives, because society tells us to develop that public side of ourselves. We develop who we are, what we want to do, and how we want to live based upon our profession, on our vocation, what we want. Because that false self in society is easily commodified. We can put a dollar amount on it. We can accumulate power with it. We can have authority with us. And all of those things, scripture and tradition tell us, is pulling us away from that true self in God. True self and what we want to do. And remember, even Jesus, when he's talking to his disciples and those who are following him, he's saying, look, you're going to have to give up a whole bunch of stuff. You're going to have to give up your families. You're going to have to give up your wealth. You're going to have to give up your possessions. You're going to have to give everything. In all four of the Gospels, he's basically saying, deny thyself and pick up that one thing that you're most afraid of, that you don't want to go, that you don't want to deal with in yourself, your cross, and follow me. Now, don't get me wrong here. I think the accumulation of knowledge, of wealth, and all those things are not evil in and of themselves. They serve a purpose of who we are and where we are at. We are called to witness at this time and in this place, and at that, for us, that means the United States at this time, and we live within that society, so we have to function within that society. But it's too easy for us to sometimes to slip into having the accumulation of wealth or stuff or knowledge or other things as the primary focus of our lives. It slips into too easily that realm of idolatry worship when we start putting those things ahead of what we are truly supposed to be following and being true to, which is Christ and the gospel. And Paul is reflecting on this struggle, because it's a struggle he's dealing with. Therefore, it is a struggle that we are dealing with today. And that struggle is how to navigate the world as followers of Christ. And by navigating the world means we are navigating sin within this world. And it is sin that is what is attributed to our false self. It is that thing that creeps into our lives that pulls us away from God and from our true self that God created us. Back to Thomas Merton, he said, all sin starts from the assumption that my false self, the self that exists only in my own egocentric desires, is the fundamental reality of life to which everything else in the universe is ordered. He's basically saying sin is when we start to allow all those things besides the gospel and Christ and walking in Christ's footsteps to guide and become our true reality. How do we follow Jesus? How do we practice following Jesus while navigating sin in the world and its effects in the world that we live in? And that's literally what Paul is reflecting on here, that struggle, that balance between what we are supposed to do and what we should be doing as followers. Here we see today a couple of things Paul doing with respect to the law. He's doing some cleanup work to begin with. First, in this passage we read, we know that the law is good, but the law is limited on how it dictates how we follow Christ and live in a Christ-centered life. In Romans chapter 3, 4, 5, and 7, Paul is talking about the connection between the law and the life of the Spirit and life in Christ, and there's some trouble there. He's basically saying, look, with the law and knowledge of the law comes sin. With the law brings wrath. The law multiplies trespasses. So there's this theme that the law may be a problem in the situation. And people started to listen to him. And they started to say, you know, maybe we don't need the law. Maybe we could just get rid of it and just follow Jesus. And that is a way that we need to go forward to be followers of Christ. That mindset kind of popped up in the church, and it was a part of church tradition at the very early start. A movement under Marcion wanted to dump basically all the Old Testament and most of the New Testament, because he believed that we should not be worshiping the Son of the God of the Israelites, that Jesus was the Son of God, and that's it. And this was prominent in the second century and well into the third and fourth century in the Eastern Church. But church and tradition pushed back against that, basically saying, no, we need the law. And I agree with them, because Jesus was a Jew in first century Palestine. We need to understand his tradition and how he was raised in order to understand what God was doing through him at that time. It's easy to just push things aside in hopes that we can get to the clear truth. But what Paul is saying here is the law is not the problem. Sin is the problem in our lives. Sin is a tyrant that will use anything, even God's law, to get what it wants and to manipulate people. Sin takes advantage of us and pulls us away from what God has asked us to do and be a part of. It pulls us away from that true self that we were created in the image of God. Or, as the Zen masters say, the face that you had before you were born. Or we could just go to the Psalms 139, verses 13 and 14. For you created my innermost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb, fearfully and wonderfully made. That is our true self. That is who we are as followers of Christ. And conversely, by looking at this and what he says about the law, we can basically say that we can have the best law out there. We can think that we have the right interpretation of that law and everything is right, but sin still exists in this situation. And sin is going to be that thing that pulls us away from what God is asking us to be a part of. Even with the best intentions, sin, we are still going to miss the mark, which is literally what that word means. Or as Paul talks about in verse 24, oh, the wretched man that I am. Those moments where we know we are doing the wrong thing, we have the rules and the laws in front of us, and what we do is the thing that we least want to do. And Paul's aware of that even when we are on our best behavior, even when we are doing all the things that we think we're doing is right, he says, man, sin is laying right there next to you. It is close by, and be careful. Always be on a lookout for that. Following Jesus means participating in our own rescue, having agency in those moments and in those times where we can basically say, no, we're going to act a certain way. This is a very Wesleyan theological perspective, that responsible grace, that gift that God has given us, and that we're supposed to respond to that gift, participating with grace of God through the Christ event, the birth, the life, the ministry, the death, the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and all that that means in our lives, but then also following that event through the Holy Spirit to spread the gospel to those that need to hear it, which is basically the Great Commission. All these are tied together with this struggle that Paul is talking about, and it's the struggle that we still face as a church and as individuals today, is how to faithfully follow Jesus in the time and place that we live. Now, at the end of this sermon series and at the most end of sermons, there is that moment of the takeaway where there should be a list of we shoulds or we must or let us. This is what Richard Rohr would talk about, how we get in touch with what we need to do next. And when we do that, we're working in those shadowy areas of our lives. Those areas that we really don't like to go into sometimes. Those areas that we would like to stay and have stay in the shadows. And he goes as far as says, no, as followers of Christ, you better get ready to do some shadow boxing. You better be willing and ready to jump into those places in your lives and start duking it out with those dark areas, with those cold areas, and figure out what that means and what you're going to do about it, because that literally is following into the true self given to us by God, that thing that we discover and have been given only a certain amount of years to do it. For us today, I'll leave you with three simple ways to follow Jesus in a sinful world. First, do no harm and avoid evil. Avoid evil. It doesn't mean that you're going to always be perfect. It just says, do no harm and avoid evil. Try that each and every moment. Secondly, do good as much as you can in all places that you can. And finally, obey in all the obediences of God. And that is within your faith tradition, what you feel comfortable doing. But if we follow those three simple general rules, as Wesley called them, we are on a path to discover our true self, allowing God to work in us and in our situation to move us back from that false self that the world has put on us and asked us to be into that true self that God has created us to be. And I hope and I pray that this week we take the opportunity to do some shadow boxing and to develop into that true self that God created us. Let us pray. Gracious God, we come to you today. We're grateful for the opportunity to read Scripture in public and in open and in this church. We're thankful for the opportunity to be able to know that we too are struggling just as Paul struggled in his faith, because it is something that we have to reckon with. And we're not doing it alone. We have a long tradition of church leaders and fathers and tradition and history that tell us that we are not alone in this moment, that we are in good company. Give us the strength and the courage this week to do that work, to develop and to see that true self that you have given us. And we do this in Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
receive this benediction, let us leave here today vowing to discover our true self, that self that God put in us when we were born, and that we have a period of time to discover and live into, and then to show others what that true self is so that they too can discover their true self in God. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.